troubles shake me, I know they could never move, yeah. Sometimes the only way through it is a hallelujah. Your problems, but it'll tell you how small they are.
That's the thing about praise.
That's the thing about praise.
It won't always move the mountain, but it's good for the heart.
That's the thing about praise.
That's the thing about praise.
Story, find my way. chalked it up to be. When we were kids in Carolina, Tennessee. So I throw my bones in the river.
Good morning. Welcome to chapel. I know it's a little cold in here. The heat's not working, so, rub your hands together. Snuggle your significant other sitting next to you. Whatever you need to do, stay warm. Welcome to chapel. Y'all ready? Ready for a spring 24 semester. Yeah. All right. Welcome to chapel. Let me just remind you again, expectations of this 45 minutes an hour. Expectations of students is this. We expect you to be respectful. So when the band's leading in worship, when they're singing, you're either participating in them and singing or you're listening, not talking to your neighbor. You're just quiet. All right. That's what we mean by respectful. When the speaker's up here, you're not on your phone. You're not watching videos. You're not talking to your neighbor. You're just being quiet and listening to the speaker. We got that? We can do that? All right, just like at the end of the semester, last semester, some of y'all didn't get that, okay? You abused that and weren't respectful. Starting today, if you're not respectful, one of the faculty or staff members may tell you to come with me. They're going to take your ID, take a picture of your ID, and you will not get credit for this semester, or you won't get credit for this chapel, okay? You do that too many times, you miss it, you don't get credit for this semester. Nobody wants that, right? So, because if you don't get chapel credit, you don't get to graduate. No chap, no cap, okay? No lie. 5 semesters, you get it? All right, so let's pray together. We'll get started. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for this opportunity that we have each week. We thank you for a new semester, a new beginning. God, we all have goals laid out before us, opportunities, and we pray, God, that you would help us to accomplish those goals. God, we commit this time to you. We pray, and we expect your Spirit to speak this morning. So each one of us, where we are, that you'd speak to us today. And may we listen to you, to your voice. We commit this time to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together.
Fall short. I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do. But every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. Except for a heart singing hallelujah. I got one response. I've got just one move. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah. Shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. So I throw up my hands praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, I've nothing else meant for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah. Praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah. Praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah.
Semester, we're going to continue our theme from last semester, Made for More. And this is the scripture that's based on, the theme is based on 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 through 10. So what we're going to do is I'm going to read the yellow, and you're going to read the white, okay, together. All right, so I'll read the yellow, you read the white. But we have this treasure in jars of clay. We are hard-pressed on every side, perplexed, persecuted, struck down. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus. May we experience the more that Jesus came and died and rose from the grave to give us. Let's continue to worship.
Thank you for today, Lord. We just thank you that you've brought us all here and given us this opportunity to be at Wayland, Lord, and just to spend this time in your presence and worshiping you, God. I pray that you would open our minds and our hearts to what you're going to say to us today and just through this semester, and that we would grow closer to you and build our relationship with you, Lord. And It's in your name we pray. Amen.
You were born into a world of broken dreams, of resentment and disillusionment birthed out of longings left unfulfilled. There seems to be no end to this relentless cycle of chasing the wind, only to have it leave you empty, hungry, yearning for more. The silence of insignificance screams at you, keeping you awake at night while you desperately search for a purpose to direct your passion. The longing unfulfilled tears at the core of your being until you succumb to the apathy that pervades this generation. But you were made for more. More than the disappointment of failed relationships. More than the fear that you'll never measure up. God is calling you, reminding you that what He's done before, He will do again. He chooses ordinary people for extraordinary miracles. He is able to do exceedingly, abundantly more. More than you can imagine. More than you can ask. More than you can dream. And He's asking, will you come with me? You were born to lead. You were created to live deeply, audaciously, fiercely connected to community and rooted in Jesus. So when the temptation to hit autopilot returns, stand up, shake off the apathy, and remember, you are made for more.
All right, you're made for more. 2 Corinthians 4, 7 through 10 goes back and it says that, but we have this treasures of jars of clay within us. When he talks about this treasure, what is he talking about? If you have this treasure in this jars of clay, what is he talking about here? What he's talking about is that we have the good news, this treasure of the good news, the gospel. We have this treasure that what he's saying is that we understand that we were created by God for God. What he's saying is that we have this, the good news is that God created each one of us to have this close, intimate relationship with Him. God created each one of us to walk with Him every day, and that our lives would find fulfillment through His, by living and walking with Him. And that's what, in the beginning, in Genesis, that's what we find. God created man, and man walked with God, and everything was great. And they had this, this intimate relationship. They walked with each other. They talked with each other. Man followed God, and then a couple chapters later, we find that man disobeyed God. God told him that he couldn't do something, and man disobeyed. Man thought he knew better than God and disobeyed. And from that point on, that relationship that God had created each one of us to have was broken. Now, God created us to walk in wholeness with Him, but now man has broken that relationship. It's like this, if you're dating someone and everything's kicking along just great, and then you find out that they cheated on you. Broken relationship or a whole relationship? Broken, right? That relationship is broken. And so God created us to have this whole relationship with Him, but we broke it by trying to do things our way. So God, what does He do? He doesn't want us to continue in that relationship, this broken relationship, so He says, I got to fix this. In Genesis 3, that word, that disobedience is a word that we call sin, and sin entered the world from first man, and so from all of us, we are born into sin. We are born in disobedience to God. God created us for this intimate relationship, but we can't live in that because we have sin. We want to do things our way. So God, in His sovereignty, and in His love, says, you know what? I'm going to send my Son, who is sinless. He's going to live for 30 years or so odd, 33 years. And then He's going to die. He's going to be crucified. He's going to die in their place. I script a verse there. It says, Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Okay, the wages of sin is death. We earn death, that separation from God. That's a spiritual death. This relationship that God created us to have, we can't have because sin is in us, each one of us. No one is innocent of that. We're all guilty. And so this relationship that God wants us to have, we can't have because of our sin. But God says, I don't want to leave you in that because I want to walk with you. I want to know you. I've made you for more, so I'm going to send my Son to die. His death is going to pay the price. And we know from Scripture that Jesus came, he lived a perfect life, he died on the cross, he was crucified for our sins, and 3 days later he rose from the grave, conquering death, sin, and hell on our behalf, so that we once again can be made new, that our relationship with God can be restored. That's the treasure that he's talking about here. He says, that's what you carry around in you. And then he says, you are jars of clay. What's the picture there is jars of clay. They're fragile. They're sometimes broken. And he's saying, you're fragile. And he says, I put this in you so that the world will see how much I love them. And then he says, this idea of being made for more. Made for more. What does he say? He says, in the scripture, he says, we are crushed. We're hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. What he's saying is there is that all the stuff that happens in our world, all the crap that happens in our world that should get us down, should throw our hands up and say, I give up, or we get angry or whatever, doesn't affect us. Because we're not affected by the circumstances, because we are being made for more, because the Spirit of God lives in me. That's what we're talking about when we talk about being made for more. This semester, we're going to focus on how the Spirit of God can help us experience all that God has for us. He's made us for more. It's more than just getting by day by day, waking up and just hoping to get to the weekend and living for the weekend. He's made us for more than that. So how do we experience that? Galatians chapter 5. If you have your Bible or on your phone, or it'll be on the screen. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13 through 26. Galatians 5, 13 says, you, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. Get that word. You're called to be free. A lot of people think that being a Christian, you can't do this, and you can't do that, and you can't have fun, and you're just a old sourpuss, and you can't do anything. But he just said, what? You are called to be free. There's freedom in living for Jesus. But then he says, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. Love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness and orgies, and the like. Paul gives us a list here, but he adds, and the like. This is not a complete list. It's just part of the list that describes living by the flesh. And then it goes on to say, I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other. So this semester, we're going to focus on what does it mean to live by the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit, those things that he just mentioned: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That's what we're going to talk about. This morning, I'm just going to give you an overview, and then from here, the speakers will talk about one aspect of what it means to live by the Spirit. But I want you to get this morning. He says in this passage, people who regularly do these things will not inherit the kingdom of God. So let's look at these things. Life in the flesh. What is he saying? If you live by the flesh, you live for yourself selfishly, and you just live for what gives you pleasure. The flesh, he says, these are things that we naturally do. We live in our sin. This is what we naturally do. This is what we want to do. Unless we're guided by the Spirit of God, this is what we're going to fall into. And he says there are four categories. The first one is sexual sin. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality. I don't have to get into great detail there. Basically, the Bible says you're to have sex with your spouse, man and woman, in the marriage relationship. Anything outside of that marriage relationship is sexual immorality. Got that? Yeah. And then he says impurity. You continue to walk in those things. You're gratifying the sinful desires. It's the flesh there that has control of you. Matt, could you turn the house lights up some? Those on the wings, I can't see. Thank you. That's perfect. So he says this sexual sins, if you continue to walk in those, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. It's evidence that you are living by the flesh. And then he goes on to say religious sin, idolatry, and sorcery and witchcraft. Most of us in this room would say, I don't have to worry about that. I don't have any idols. And we think about idols in the Bible. They created these wooden idols, these figures are out of stone, and that's what they worship. They had them in their homes, and they would worship these idols. Well, none of us have those. But here's the deal. Today, idols for us is anything that we put above God. Anything that we wouldn't say this, but our actions reflect that this is more important than God is. It could be a relationship with somebody. Your shoddy could be them. It could be your sport. That your sport, your athletic endeavor, your dreams are more important than your relationship with God. Anything that you put in front of your relationship with God is an idol to you. And he says, you continue to do that. It's evidence that you're walking in the flesh. And then he says social sins, which is enmity and strife and jealousy, fits of anger, dissension, divisions, envy. Nobody wants to be around people that all they do is stir the pot and cause trouble, and they're just hateful people. So he says these social sins, and then he says alcohol-related sins, drunkenness and orgies. When he talks about drunkenness, and you know, the Bible says don't get drunk. So if you do that, what are you doing? You're just, I'm in control. I know what's best for me. I'm going to do what I want to do, and it makes me feel good, so I'm going to do it. And so it says, if that's your life, if that's a description of your life, it's obvious you're living in the flesh, and you will not be able to experience all that God has for you. You will not be able to experience the more. Now, how are you going to experience the more? Nobody wants to just go through life humdrum and just make it from day to day. We want to experience all that God has for us. So how do we do that? He says, you walk in the Spirit. He said, back in the verse, it says that you have freedom, that you look at those things, but I like to drink, and I like to have sex, and I like to, you know, gossip, and I like to do this, and I like to do that, and you're like, I like to do all this stuff of the flesh, or maybe I just fall into that stuff. Maybe it's not I just like it, but I just fall into it. The Bible says if you follow Christ and you live by the Spirit, that's where freedom is. Not just living for yourself and doing whatever you want to do, gratifying your own fleshly desires, but it's through the Spirit of God that you have freedom. So how do you experience the more that God has for you? You walk in the Spirit, and the Spirit produces these things. He produces love. But what is love? When he describes love here, excuse me, when he describes love here, it's not, you know, I can say I love my wife, and I can say I love chocolate. Do I mean the same thing there? No, of course not. Okay? So when I say love, when he describes love, it's that you unconditional love. It doesn't matter what this person does to me. I'm going to love them. Everyone in this room would want to say, that's how I want to be loved. Because in our relationships with each other, we're going to mess up. We're going to screw up. We're going to make the other person angry. And if we don't have that type of love, they're going to walk away. But so if you live in the Spirit, I'm able to love my wife that way. That's a better example. She's able to love me that way because I screw up all the time. Sometimes I have a short fuse and she says something and I snap and yell. Well, if she didn't love me this kind of way, she'd have walked away a long time ago. So you want this kind of love? Walk in the Spirit. And then he says joy. Joy is not something that's produced by our circumstance. We normally just think, I have joy, and we clap and we sing because things are going right with me. Coach, I've moved up the depth chart. Now I'm the starter. Things were great. Then I get injured, and now life sucks, and my joy is gone. No, I can have joy because I have a relationship with Jesus. And it's not determined by my circumstances. It's determined by my relationship with God. I have joy. Peace. Now, when we talk about peace and, you know, the Miss Universe pageant, what's your platform? What do you want? I want world peace. And what they're talking about is I want the world to be free from opposition and hurt and pain. Well, this piece is talking about even in the midst of your pain, even in the midst of your circumstances that aren't the greatest, you can still have peace. You can still be whole. That's what he's talking about here. When he's talking about living by the Spirit, this is what I want. Patience. Patience is putting up with people when they're on your last nerve. And I tell you, I need help with that one. I need help being patient. Kindness. It's showing goodness and generosity to others when they don't necessarily deserve it. Goodness means working for the benefit of others and not yourself. Faithfulness means you're faithful no matter what. Every one of us would say, excuse me, covering that up didn't help much, did it? Faithfulness means that you're faithful no matter what, that you can count on them no matter what the circumstances are. You're faithful. They're a person of their word. Gentleness means that you are consistently humble towards God and to others, and you reflect gentleness to those around you. Self-control. Self-control means that gives you victory over your fleshly desires. Now, I'm going to tell you a story, and I'm not proud of this story. I went back and forth. Should I tell this story? Should I not? So here it goes. We'll find out later if I should have told it. We're on break, right? And we were traveling to Waco, Texas, to see my daughter. And my son and his wife were traveling behind us. It was me and Lori, my wife, driving. And we're on Highway 36 out of Abilene. It's a two-lane road. And if it gets backed up, you're just stuck, okay? So that's what happened this day. There was two trucks in front of us, and then there were three cars. And then there was me and my son. And we're driving along, just, you know, not even going the speed limit, which gets me frustrated. Anybody else? Can't drive the speed limit. It just drives me nuts. And then this truck shows up. This 18-wheeler shows up right behind my son. He pulls in behind him, just blaring. I'm going, he's fixing to run over Josh, my son. And he didn't. But we're traveling, and we're doing this for like 10 minutes, 15 minutes. And all of a sudden, this truck, I mean, there are hills out there. All of a sudden, this 18-wheeler behind Josh comes out and starts to pass him. And I'm going, where the heck is this guy going? I mean, there are seven cars in front of him. Where does this idiot think he's going? And then all of a sudden, he sees a car coming in his lane, and he'll step on his brake, and he'll get back over. He did that 4-5 times. I was furious. This guy's going to get us all killed. So we get to the stoplight where we turn there in Comanche. We pull up into the gas station there, and he goes on, and he's coming around. And you know what I did? This good spiritual life director did? I just flipped him off. My wife looks at me like, what are you doing? You know what the trucker did? He just waved at me. Kept on going down the road. In that moment, I was living in the flesh. There was no self-control in me. If there had been self-control, I would have thought, I'm going to flip that guy off. And I would have thought, no, that's not what I need to do. But see, when you live in the Spirit, you're able to say no to what the flesh desires you to do. He says in this passage, verse 24, he says, those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. If we're going to experience the more, we got to live in the Spirit. God has made us for the more. I'm crushed. I mean, I'm pushed down, but I'm not crushed. I'm not abandoned because I'm in step with the Spirit of God. Now, how do you get in step with the Spirit of God? It's surrender. It's surrender. It's submission. Because again, I said in the beginning, this is not natural to us. It's not natural for me to be patient and kind and gentle, self-control. It's not natural for me to love you unconditionally. That's not my nature. So I have to surrender to the Spirit and submit to Him. Now let me tell you this. This surrender is a constant thing. It's a constant thing. It's not once and done. Okay, I got it. Surrendered. We're good. I'm going to live like Jesus or live for Jesus the rest of my life. No. It's a daily thing. Let me illustrate it this way. Imagine a Cherokee elder was talking to his grandson about the battle that goes on within. That there's a battle that goes on in ourself, in our souls. And he says there's two wolves inside of you. There's an evil one, and that's the one who has anger and envy and jealousy and sorrow and regret and greed and arrogance. And then there's the good one. The good wolf is the one that has joy and peace and love and hope, humility, kindness, generosity, truth, compassion, faith. And these two wolves are fighting each other. They're at battle every day that these two wolves are fighting each other. And the grandson asked him, well, which wolf wins? Which wolf wins the battle? And the old Cherokee grandfather simply replied to his grandson, the one you feed. The one you feed wins the battle every time. This passage of Scripture, Paul reminds us that those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and its desire. We are called to live by the Spirit. And this means actively choosing each day that I'm going to live by the Spirit. I'm going to submit to the Spirit of God. I'm not going to live for myself. I'm not going to live for the desires of the flesh. I'm going to surrender to the Holy Spirit. And when we surrender to Him, He allows Him to guide our thoughts, our actions, our desires. And we can overcome the impulses of the flesh. And we can grow to be more like Jesus. The flesh and the spirit are in a battle. The one you feed will win every time. So the question today is this. Do you want more? You want freedom? You want to experience love, unconditional? Joy? You want peace in your life? You want to be patient with those around you? You want to experience kindness and goodness? You want to be a faithful person? You want to have self-control? Do you want the words of 2 Corinthians to describe you? I'm hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. I'm perplexed, but not in despair. I'm persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. If you want the more, it's daily surrender to the Spirit of God. It's daily saying yes to Jesus. In order to do that, you've got to say yes to Jesus first. One time you, for salvation, you surrender your life to Him. And I know the number of people in this room, there's some people in this room who have never said yes to Jesus. And in the beginning, that good news that I talked about, that your sin separates you from God, but God doesn't leave you in your sin. He sent His Son to die on the cross. The Bible says that if you believe that and you put your faith in that, you bet your life on that, you enter into a relationship with Jesus. You enter a relationship to God. And some of you need to do that because you've never done that. Some of you need to say yes to Jesus for the first time. So when chapel's over, if that's you and you'd say, Donnie, I don't have that relationship, but I want that, I want that. I'm going to be at the front. I think JR's here. He'll be here. Some others will be here at the front. When we dismiss, you just come up here and say, I want that relationship with Jesus. I don't have that. Okay, the other group that's sitting in here does have a relationship with Jesus. You've said yes to Him, and you know today that if you were to die, you'd spend eternity with Him. You've got that. You've nailed that. But maybe you're here this morning, and you've strayed away. That, yeah, I have a relationship with Jesus, but, you know, I got to college, and I could be my own person. I could do whatever I want to, and I've been living in the flesh, and I want to come back today. All you have to do is say, Jesus, I'm sorry. I submit. I surrender to You. Take my semester. Take my life. And You do what You want to do, not what I want to do. And then tomorrow, you do that again. And you feed the good wolf by spending time with Him, by spending time with Jesus. And the spirit wins instead of the flesh. If you need prayer about that, in a moment, we'll conclude our service. And I'll be at the front. Others will be here. If you want prayer for that, you can come. Ask for prayer and we'll pray for you. All right, let's pray together. We have one other thing to do. So after my prayer, don't start getting up and leaving, okay? Father, we thank You today for Your Spirit being in this room. We thank You that You've spoken to us very directly this morning. That if we live by the flesh, we will not inherit the kingdom of God. We will not be able to experience the life that You came to give us. So, Father, help us to say no to the flesh and yes to You. I pray for those in this room this morning that don't have a relationship with You, their Creator. that today they might seek you out and enter into that relationship today. And Lord, those of us who are struggling with the flesh and following our own desires, our own way, that we'd surrender to you today. That we'd say yes to you today, and we'd say we want to live by your Spirit and not our own way. So God, help us have the courage and the strength to say yes to you. For in that, we find the more. In that, we find all that you've created us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, we have a special presentation that we want to do. I'm going to ask the men's golf team and Coach Harp to come on up here. You guys come on up. Y'all go this way. Y'all can grab what he has over here for you guys. Come on. What you need to know is we are now in two athletic associations. One is the NAIA, and the other one is the National Christian College Athletic Association. I'll say more about that in a minute, but we're going to let Coach Harp and his guys come on up. I think that's good, Coach.
Thank you so much, Donnie, for the time and opportunity to recognize these young men, the hard work they put in for years. Right quick, before I kind of introduce some of these guys' accomplishments, I wanted to kind of share a motto that's been part of our team since I started. I started in 01, but it was a difference maker for the teams that we've had over the years, and I believe it's a difference maker for each one of you and the teams that you represent, even if you're not in a sport, just the friend that's sitting next to you. Inside of the championship rings that we have, the belts that we have, is a motto, and it's called Speak Life. And the friend that you have next to you, the teammate that's next to you, needs you to share life with them. There's so many things that happen in the middle of a game, can be in practice. We all go through some challenges and difficult moments. But the power of life and death is in the tongue, and speaking life to your friend is so critical. So I just encourage you to, in those moments this semester, to speak life to your teammates and encourage them. So 23 was a huge year for this team. It started this spring. We played the SAC championship. Second time in school history they won the SAC championship. And the team members on that team were Zane Welburn, Benjamin Lubker, Carson Graywunder, Vlastimil Miller, Jay Nathwani. It was really just a great finish. We had a lot of challenges during the year, and it was just a great finish to that year. They finished top 10 in the country. On top of winning the SAC championship, they have four of these young men were academic All-Americans. Benjamin Lubker, Carson Graywunder, Vlastimil, and Jay were all four academic All-Americans. Congratulations to them. We went on to the fall, and for the first time we competed at the NCCAA National Championship in Florida. We played at Hammock Beach, the Ocean Course, and it was an incredible event. The NCCAA did an incredible job hosting a championship, and it was a lot of fun, great time, and the team there was Zane Welburn led our team. He was the low guy on the team. Ben Lubker and Carson Graywunder and Vlastimil Miller and Sasha Brendel. Sasha joined us from France. He was a freshman on the team, made the team for this fall, and so that was a great time. They were also All-Americans. We had three All-Americans on the team. Zane Welburn, Ben Lubker, and Sasha were the three All-Americans for the team. So anyway, congratulations on an incredible 23. You guys have the banner. If you guys hold the, Jay, grab the banner right over there. It's on the side.
(Clears throat)
Thanks so much.
Y'all stay right there for a second. Why are we doing this during chapel? This is why, okay? 1 Corinthians 10:31 says, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. We're a Christian university. Our foundation is on Christ, and everything we do should be about Him, bringing Him glory. Now, I've been at Wayland 23 years, and I think in those 23 years, I think that we've won national champions like 3 times, okay? And so it's important to recognize these guys as national champions, okay? And so here's what we're going to do. If you're in a spring sport, okay, that would be baseball, golf, basketball. I know it's kind of both and. Wrestling, softball. Is that all of them? Cheer. If you're in one of those sports, I want you to stand up. Just stand up where you are. Everybody, stand up. If you're in a spring sport, stand up. Track and field. That's what I'm saying. Y'all tell me. Track and field, stand up. All right? Keep standing if you're one of these sports. We're going to pray for you right now, okay? We're going to pray that God, that through you, through your sport, God receive the glory, okay? So let's pray together. Father, we thank you for these athletes. God, we know it takes a lot of effort and a lot of time, a lot of energy. God, that they've put in a lot to participate in their sport. God, I pray that they would be successful. But Lord, most importantly, we pray not for wins and losses. Yeah, we pray for the wins, but Lord, we pray that these students, as they compete, as they practice, that they would do what Coach said, that they would speak life into each other, and that their lives would point to you. So God, I pray for their coaches. I pray that the coaches instill in them that that's what this is all about. And God, that these teams would reflect you and your love to those who they're competing against and those people that are in the stands and those who interact with them at the hotels and the convenience stores, everywhere they go. Lord, may they reflect you. And so, God, we pray your blessings upon them. I'm going to ask all students to stand now. Everybody stand. God, we know that you have incredible things in store for us. If we'll submit to you, you'll take us to places we'd experience things that we never dreamed about. That we'd experience an abundant life that can only be found in you. So God, today we submit to you. We submit this semester to you. And we pray, Lord, that you would have your way. We pray your blessings upon these students. May they find success. May they reach their goals this semester. But most importantly, may they submit to you and find all and experience all that you have in store for them. In Jesus' name, amen. If you need to talk, I'll be here at the front. You're dismissed.
Come together, my people, my tribe. When we come together. It's on.